ISIS terrorists forced thousands to flee from the city of Ramadi, where American troops died during intense warfare in some of the darkest days of the Iraq War. This is Special Report. Good evening. Welcome to Washington. I'm Brett Baer. Iraqis are fleeing tonight from land that was fought for with American lives. ISIS terrorists are advancing on the Anbar provincial capital city of Ramadi, site of some of the deadliest clashes during the war. The U.S. response now is being questioned. Correspondent Doug McElway has tonight's top story from the Pentagon.
This video purports to show U.S. airstrikes on ISIS forces yesterday in Ramadi, the capital of Anbar province, only 100 miles from Baghdad. ISIS is now advancing on this city of 500,000 and has captured three of its suburbs. Another ISIS advance to the north in the more strategic oil-rich city of Beji.
I would much rather that Ramadi not fall, but it won't be the end of a campaign. Should it fall, we got to get it back. Beji is a more strategic target, and that's why the focus right now is, in fact, on Beji.
These surprising gains coming only 3 weeks after ISIS suffered a major blow in Tikrit. Iraqi Prime Minister al-Abadi, still in Washington, acknowledged defeating the Islamic State will be elusive.
This is a war, and a war you can win in a place and lose somewhere else.
Abadi delivered a veiled criticism of his Arab allies who promised support against ISIS but have been slow to deliver, a criticism which he also leveled at U.S. bombing missions.
But we're talking about time scale between asking for a mission and then actually getting the mission. That's vital, especially when we are fighting a war on the ground.
Secretary of Defense Ash Carter, in his first press conference at the Pentagon, today offered one possible explanation for those delays.
We're not using our own forward controllers to do that in Tikrit or anywhere else in Iraq.
But congressional critics say we should be more hands-on.
We're talking about having our people more engaged in helping the Iraqis fight the fight. That means directing the targets, helping access their access on the ground in terms of their movement.
Others complain that U.S. airstrikes comprise only a small fraction of sortie totals that the Pentagon often publicizes.
Right now, in our airstrikes in Iraq and Syria, of the 12,000 sorties, 3,000 of them actually drop weapons. Is that true?
I think that's about right, sir.
The Pentagon today noted that there were 19 airstrikes over the last 24 hours, while the White House was touting a bigger picture of success in Iraq.
By backing the ground forces in Iraq with coalition military air power, we have substantially improved their performance on the battlefield, such that 25% to 30% of the populated areas that ISIL previously controlled, they no longer do.
But Ramadi is said to be a ghost town as thousands of civilian refugees flee to Baghdad. It has prompted a new humanitarian crisis in Iraq, one of the reasons that President Obama has pledged $200 million to a humanitarian aid just yesterday. Brett?
Doug McElway, live at the Pentagon. Doug, thank you. What do you think? Do you think the U.S. is doing enough to fight ISIS in Iraq? Let me know at facebook.com/BrettBaerSR or on Twitter at Brett Baer. You can use the hashtag Special Report. The European Union says talks with Iran over its nuclear program will resume next week. News earlier this month that the U.S. and its allies had agreed to a framework of a deal ostensibly has led to Russia's decision to supply Iran with formidable air defenses. Correspondent Kevin Cork has reaction tonight from the White House.
We think that given the conditions in the region, particularly in relation with the events in Yemen, the supplies of this type of weaponry are a deterrent factor.
A deterrent for Iran and a symbol of increasing cooperation between Moscow and Tehran. President Vladimir Putin, in a four-hour-long call-in TV show, defended the sale of a missile defense system to Iran amid growing concerns from the Obama administration that it could complicate the ongoing nuclear arms talks.
If some people are concerned that we started canceling sanctions, then apparently our colleagues don't know that supplies of these types of systems are not included in the UN sanctions list.
While the sale doesn't violate UN sanctions or even the framework agreed to in Switzerland 2 weeks ago, it does offer a glimpse into the strained relationship between the White House and the Kremlin, even as they look to keep nuclear weapons out of Iran.
We can work constructively with Russia in a way that benefits both our countries. That doesn't, however, prevent Russia from doing some things that we do strongly disagree with.
Like selling missiles that could enhance Iran's defensive capabilities. Like Russian warplanes harassing American surveillance aircraft. Like invading Ukraine and violating a ceasefire agreement.
Are the Russians friends? Are they foes? Are they frenemies? Are they somewhere in between? It just seems like there's always something.
Well, Kevin, I think we've articulated on a number of occasions that the United States does have a complicated relationship with Russia.
Complicated even further by Putin's desire to reward Iran for showing, quote, a desire to compromise in the talks, a decision that could weaken President Obama's hand and embolden the Iranians.
Our will and determination is to seriously continue the negotiations until a deal is reached. Of course, the other parties should have the same will.
Meanwhile, on Capitol Hill, a stern warning from lawmakers about the ongoing negotiations.
Hope John Kerry will be honest with the Iranians that I have to get this deal through Congress, and I can't get a deal through Congress that allows the sanctions to be relieved immediately and doesn't have an intrusive inspection regime anytime, anywhere.
Lindsey Graham of South Carolina. Now, Brett, I want everybody to remember this. Follow the money. Like Iran, Russia's economy has been ravaged by sanctions and falling oil prices. And so the sale of this missile system to Iran is about making money right now and perhaps cementing a future relationship with a regional power that's still looking to get back onto the world economic stage.
Kevin Cork, live on the North Lawn. Kevin, thank you. Officials in Yemen say al-Qaeda terrorists have taken control of a major airport, a seaport, and an oil terminal in the south. They say insurgents clashed with members of one of the country's largest infantry brigades outside Mukalla, and that many leaders of that brigade ran away. Several former platoon mates of Sergeant Bo Bergdahl say the country's top military official knew that Bergdahl had deserted. Yet Bergdahl was hailed as a hero by the Obama administration when it traded five Taliban commanders to get him back. The men say in 2009, then Joint Chiefs Chairman Admiral Mike Mullen acknowledged the desertion while visiting Afghanistan.
Matt asked him, you know Bergdahl deserted, and what's going on with that, basically? And Admiral Mullen said, yes, we know all the circumstances surrounding Bergdahl walking away from the OP, and we're still working on getting him back.
After a lengthy investigation, the Army announced last month it is charging Bergdahl with desertion. The Clinton Foundation will go right on accepting foreign money during Hillary Clinton's run for the presidency. Chief White House correspondent Ed Henry has an update on the campaign tonight.
Top advisors to Hillary Clinton confirmed today her second presidential campaign swing will be to New Hampshire next Monday and Tuesday after completing what they felt was an effective low-key launch in Iowa.
Corey, how are you?
And while former President Bill Clinton signaled before the kickoff he'd be taking a backseat role, there are new signs he will be pushed into the spotlight as Republicans continue to pounce on revelations about foreign donations to the Bill, Hillary, and Chelsea Clinton Foundation.
Hillary Clinton's argument. You've heard her argument for taking money from Saudi Arabia. Oh, she's going to do good things with it. And yet she's taking money from a country that persecutes women. She takes money from the Sultan of Brunei. What do they do in Brunei? If you're accused of adultery, you're stoned to death.
While Hillary Clinton stepped down from the board on Sunday, the foundation is planning to continue raking in big money from some foreign governments, even as she campaigns for president. The foundation today confirmed a Wall Street Journal report that for the duration of the campaign, it will limit donations to a handful of countries, Australia, Canada, Germany, the Netherlands, Norway, and the UK, that are already supporting multi-year programs. Foundation spokesman Craig Manassian declaring in a statement, quote, by implementing this new, even stronger and more transparent policy, the Clinton Foundation is reinforcing its commitment to accountability while protecting programs that are improving the lives of millions of people around the world.
First, she's not at the foundation anymore. And secondly, it's all charitable work, fighting AIDS in Africa, climate change, responding to earthquake disaster relief in Haiti.
Despite that good work, Clinton has not yet mentioned the foundation on the campaign trail, though she did recently note a subsidiary, the Clinton Global Initiative, had worked with the private sector to create thousands of jobs.
That's the kind of creative work that we can do together, and I'm obviously proud that CGI was the
convener to make that happen.
Now, under the new rules, government officials from countries like Saudi Arabia will be allowed, though, to make smaller contributions to the Clinton Global Initiative. Of course, we've not been able to ask the candidate about any of this. He's just not taking any questions yet. Maybe 4-hour Putin-style call-in show, Brett.
Maybe so. Welcome back from Iowa. Heading out again next week.
We'll be in New Hampshire Monday and Tuesday. What we're hearing from officials is she'll probably do 2 days a week in several key battleground states, and then mid-May sum up the listening tour with a big speech.
Okay, Ed, thanks.
Good to see you.
Up next, Republicans, many Republican candidates and potential candidates are heading to one of the early primary states. First, here's what some of our Fox affiliates around the country are covering tonight. Fox 4 in Dallas says the tour bus for Lady Antebellum catches fire on Interstate 30. Singer Hillary Scott posted on Instagram that everyone made it out safely. This is a rental bus. The group's regular ride is apparently being prepped for the tour. Fox 40 in Sacramento, California, where a federal judge has refused to remove marijuana from the list of most dangerous drugs. The judge's ruling keeps marijuana in the same class of drugs as heroin and LSD with no accepted medical use. That designation has brought states with legalized marijuana use in conflict with federal law. And this is a live look at New York from our affiliate Fox 5. Signs have been posted around Manhattan and Brooklyn discouraging catcalling. A nonprofit company, Feminist Apparel, paid for those signs. They're not authorized by the city, and at least one of them has been removed so far. That's tonight's live look outside the Beltway from Special Report. We'll be right back.